Hello, you wonderful people, and welcome to another episode of Super Fantify. This being a show where I talk about TV shows of the supernatural, fantasy, and or science fictional genre. For today's episode, I'm going to talk about Quantum Leap Season 1, Episode 12. A lot of really interesting things went down in this episode, so let's break it down. Well, first and foremost, once again, that whole genre-bending element to this series, I think it's always interesting, where it's like, yeah, like, this episode was kind of like multiple things. Obviously, it was an episode about the trans community, but it was also kind of like inspirational basketball movie, you know, storyline kind of roped into one. And I think it was such an interesting, I like that being the, obviously the setting to like tell like a very, you know, a very real and very, because it is getting that lens, getting to view the world through that lens. I don't think I know anyone personally that's trans. So this is always like, I've never had that personally in my life. So I've always obviously heard like stories from, you know, a very like outside perspective, just people in the world. I've gotten that perspective. I've never had that perspective very close to home type of situation. So, and obviously, you know, the facets in which they cover this topic, like all across the board, because I mean, you have, because I was surprised that that's where this started off at, because like, okay, it's like Ben's in a coach's body, a high school girls basketball team coach, and with the whole Amanda thing, I thought she was going to end up being like the focus of, because like, oh, she's injured and she's got these scouts, and I thought that was, and then Gia gets brought in, and you're like, are you sure you want to put Gia in? I was like, wait, why is that in this? I was thinking like, oh, is it just because Gia, like, is she not very good at basketball? Is she kind of like, oh, are you really putting her, your worst player in, something like that? It's like, no. And then we find out like, oh, Gia's trans. And I was like, oh. And then you add in that Ben is in Carlos, her father's body, which makes that situation even more complicated. But it's like, I think that's so interesting, because that the trans conversation is, I think that's a, I mean, once again, that's coming from an outside perspective, that being such a complicated thing in life when you wish it wasn't complicated. You wish that it, and even Gia's parents wishing it wasn't like that. They wish they wouldn't have to worry about, you know, having to keep their child. I mean, any parent worries about keeping their child safe, but even more so in that situation where it's like, you know, it's like, right, you being different is such an issue, you know? And I mean, that's all across the board. But I also appreciate the episode also covering the fact it's like, yeah, that's a whole conversation in its own, because there's layers to it, because it's like, right, being trans, being like a different ethnicity, a different background, like you add that on top of other elements. But, you know, because Ben tried to say, oh, did I tell you about my friend Ben Song? He's a Korean kid that went to an all-white school. It's like, yes. And she's like, and Gia's like, yes, I'm sure things were tough for your friend Ben, which she's not trying to discount that, but it's a different conversation when you compare that to a trans situation. That's why I'm like, everyone's struggles are different, you know? It's not something that, it's not like one thing you can kind of equate all across the board. Yes, it's a struggle that, you know, that being treated like an outsider, and how people make you feel about yourself, that conversation. But it's like, there's varying degrees of that for different people with different backgrounds and different circumstances. So those struggles vary from person and group to group. So I thought that was such an, I think that was kind of a poignant point to kind of like introduce into the episode in that regard as well. And, especially because it's like, right, I think anyone at any point in their life would struggle with that, those circumstances. And you add on top of that, you're in high school, which high school can be such a complicated point in your life too. So you add all of that and the complicated thing for Gia, where it's just like, right, like Carlos and Miriam, like his wife, which actually play her, Gia's mom, Miriam. I'm like, I feel like I know her from something. I just can't quite place what I knew her from. But, like, Carlos and Miriam are doing everything they can to protect their daughter, because it's like, right, you deciding to put Gia out on the court, like, even if it's just for one game, has massive consequences, because the principal has issue with it, because it's like, right, don't drag our school into your controversy, which I know that's, I mean, and I think that's also a poignant point to bring up, because obviously that was 2012, I mean, it's still applicable now, because I know that's, like, an aspect of, and then do correct me if I'm wrong, because I am still a little ignorant on the subject, but I think that is kind of one of those subjects about like, oh, like when you like, is that something that, I think conversations about whether that's something that should be taught in school and stuff like that, you know? So it's like, yeah, schools, like, we're, this is going to be like a political free zone, and we don't want to be dragged into this controversy. You're putting us in the forefront of this type of situation. So there's that conversation to that. And you know, and it's, I think at the heart of all of this is just a person who just wants to be themselves, to be accepted, you know. And all on top of that, too, it's like, I love that, you know, because later on she finds out from her parents, like, wait, you guys set it up so I could be on the team as long as I never actually got on a court. And for her, it's like she felt like she was being gaslit by her parents. It's like, wait, you kept telling me like my turn was going to come up. It was just a matter of time. And she kept probably, you know, practicing and being ready. Like, okay, it's at one point I'm going to get my opportunity. And when she finally got it, she was so excited because she had been benched for so long. But then it's like, oh, the game was always stacked against me because you guys had set it up that I was never going to get on the court. That was the deal when Dad took this job here, you know. And that principal, for one, was, in my personal opinion, you're stupid for having that conversation. You're an idiot for having that conversation. I mean, I'm glad the conversation happened. I'm glad Gia found out. But it's also like, you, oh, this wooden door where we can still audibly hear you. And it's just like, why would you have that conversation there and then? And it's just like, oh, this big secret, like, you didn't even have to say anything. But obviously for Ben, he had no idea, like, oh, this was already what's going on. Obviously he doesn't have Carlos's memories in this. And it's a sad thing too, especially considering the sad truth with Gia is that Gia ended up running away and they never found her. Her parents never found her. And you find out later on, the reason why they never found her is because sadly she was misgendered. And so they never even knew whatever happened to their daughter, and she died. And it's like, that sucks. Because obviously it's like 2023 present day. And it's like, I who knows like how far in the future that Ziggy's kind of accounting for that. Probably up to present day. So that's still like 12, 11 years of them never, 10 or 11 years of them not knowing whatever happened to their daughter, which is heartbreaking, you know? Just because of that. And, you know, Ben, you know, trying to find a way of like, okay, especially because she luckily has a group for her. Like, it's parents with trans kids who are gathering, being like, okay, you know, they wish that people obviously wouldn't see their children as like other, like, these are just my children, our children, you know, don't want to feel ostracized, like, let them kind of be themselves and kind of start treating them like there's something else, like there's something wrong with them. And like I said, I feel like they did a great job of like kind of making poignant points about this like conversation. Once again, and this is also someone who is ignorant on the subject talking about it. Like I said, like I know a little bit here and there, but I will never ever consider myself like an expert on the subject because I'm not part of that community. I don't know that personal struggle, you know? And her mentor from Gia, when Gia ran away, she ended up going to her mentor for help. Her mentor, the person who's kind of like her what's the word, from the support group. I think she's kind of the head of the support group, but she ended up being there for Gia, saying like, right, I did what I had to do when I was a teenager, but that's because I didn't have your support system. Like, yes, your parents are going to make mistakes, but they're still there. They're still trying. It's not like they don't love you, but for, you know, and they are going to stumble, and like, you have that, you have a luxury not a lot of people do, you know? Because she kind of told Gia a little bit of her story too, where there was a term that they use, and it's like it was like a very specific like house like thing that she was a part of, that I think, you know, she's like, right, I have my other like other people in the trans community to help me. And I was like, part of me was like, because I haven't seen the show, I've heard nothing but good things about it, was like, I was wondering, is that a similar thing to Pose? Like, what that show is about, like, that community? I was wondering if that's what she was referencing when she was talking about that. That's what immediately came to my head, because I'm like, is that what she was talking about? Because she was like, yeah, it's not kind of like RuPaul's Drag Race type of, like, I think she was saying, like, not that type of drag environment type of situation where it's kind of like put on such a main stage. And that's, once again, that was my interpretation of, like, yeah, it's not quite that. It's this. And that's why I'm kind of, because I think Pose was kind of like that, but I think more in a local. Once again, I'm talking about a show I haven't seen, but that's what I was wondering if that was what that was in reference to. But Gia having that conversation later on with her parents, where it's like, I get it, I love that you guys want to protect me, but it's also like, you got to let me just be a kid too. Like, the fact of the matter is, your fear shouldn't be mine. It's and the other person being like, she's like, you don't have, like, you need to stop treating, because her mom was like, we wanted to try and protect you from the burden of, like, you know, the world treating you this way. It's like, yeah, but don't treat your daughters being trans like a burden. And it's like, once again, Gia's saying, your fear is kind of what's suffocating me. Like, allow me to live my life. Let me play basketball. Let me go out, hang out with my friends. Let me stay out too late. Let me make mistakes like any other teenager. Like, don't treat me like you would any other teen. Like, treat me like your child. Treat me in the way, just let me know that you love me and you support me and you have my back, but also just let me be me, especially in a situation where it's like, I already had the world telling me I'm one thing, and me also having that struggle when I look at my own reflection. Once again, I get that. Like, I don't like looking at my own reflection from, you know, I have a lot of deep-seated issues that I have a lot of self-esteem issues. So, once again, there's parallels, but I don't know that particular situation. I can know a fraction of those circumstances, but I won't have that full experience of someone who struggles with who they see looking back at themselves in a reflection, you know? So, because I also thought it was kind of an interesting parallel, too, with, like, Ben's circumstances of, hey, he walks a mile in different people's shoes and circumstances all the time, and now you have a daughter, you know, because that was a whole conversation. Like, I don't know, like, Ben was like, I don't know how to be a parent to a trans child, and it's like, just any parent. Like, everyone's figuring it out at the same time. The child, or even someone who's going through it as an adult, like, everyone is finding their own way through it, and, you know, they just need love and support, you know? And especially, I thought, was getting Ian's side of things, too. Or, like, Ian talked about how this kind of, that they didn't go to the same school as Gia, but they heard about Gia. But, like, in the original timeline, and even in this new timeline, before they changed things again, Gia still ended up running away, sadly. But Ian told their story in that. And I thought that was such a beautiful and obviously very sad description of, like, right, for Ian, it's like, I was always in a gray area. For everyone else, it was always so black and white, you know, and people kind of feeling like you, making you feel like you weren't worthy. And Ian luckily had a group, like, you know, just like Gia has basketball, Ian had the coding club. And even finding out, like, Ian tried to kill themselves when they were 13 just because they didn't feel like they belonged. Like, it's like, yes, like, it's like, I knew I came from a family that loved me, but you still feel alone and isolated. So, and Addison also adding the element from the military perspective of, it's, you know, that whole band situation, which she's like, I knew of, like, a lot of obviously great people who were trans, but they didn't get the heads up about what was happening. I knew, and she felt like she didn't do enough for them. I think that's even more so why she wanted to make sure, it's like, especially being there for Ian, it's like, you're always there for us, so let us be there for you. And you've been there for, like, in me in particular, time and time again. But I think also that's also what pushes her even more so with the whole Gia of it all, because it's like, yeah, I made a mistake where she regrets, like, not feeling like she didn't do enough, and now it's my opportunity to try and help, you know, Gia and Ian. You know, it's like, even when things ever get that dark again, like, come to me, like, I'm here. Yeah, I even love that that line from Ian where it's like, right, you don't need an ally sometimes Which an ally is nice, but what you need is an accomplice. And I thought that was so beautiful. Even later on, when Addison brought Ian into like that chamber that lets her, you know, go holographically go to Ben. You know, it's like, oh, and in that moment, her kind of being an accomplice, like bringing Ian in as well, so that they got to see Gia's game and everything. And obviously, it's like there were people who showed up to support Gia, but there's also people who showed up, you know, for hate. But, you know, drowning that out with love. Even the fact is that Amanda even changed her position on things because it was the conversation of, it's like, yeah, what if so-and-so got this scholarship thing, the scouting thing instead of you? It's like, yeah, I'd be jealous, but I'd support them. It's like, well, would the same thing happen for me? And Amanda was like, it's complicated. You know, it's not the same thing. It's like, I just want to know we're on the same team. And Amanda's like, well, we are on the same team. And it changed because I think it's a combination of just like, right. Like, I'm not saying like, oh, like, people are allowed to grow and change and adapt and realize like, oh, okay. Like, I'm kind of on the wrong side of this and kind of grow and realize. Because I think for her, you know, seeing how her mom's coming at this from such a hateful standpoint, I think, you know, can change your mind about things. And you can formulate your own opinions. You can kind of come to your own conclusions without like your parents being like, you know, because that's the sad thing. Like, obviously, like, sometimes I feel like it's not always applicable, but sometimes I do feel like hate can be such a learned thing where it's just like someone can be so hateful because they were raised to be hateful, which isn't applicable to all hate. Some hate people come to it themselves just because it's like, oh, you're different. This is something different, and it doesn't fit into the quote unquote norm, you know. So, kind of sad Ben didn't get to, like, stick around to kind of celebrate, but it's like, because, like, the moment they won the game and Gia got the final shot in the game, you know, everyone kind of, once again, Ben making that, you know, once again, basketball movie speech of, like, put your heart into it, give it all you've got, regionals or nationals or regionals or no regionals, make sure you kind of put it all out there in the court. Each and every one of you has earned your spot here, so do it. And, you know, Amanda being like, yo, when I get it, I'm going to pass, like, we got this, you know? And just kind of like, just as he's halfway through cheering, it's when he ends up leaping to the next situation, so... So that's one of those circumstances where I think it's just, I thought that was also an interesting thing too about Ian making a point of saying like, their story is just one of so many. Like, my story isn't special in that regard because there's so many stories like it. That's the thing. And I think maybe that's why they didn't do the thing of like, okay, so what is Gia's story? And because I guess it all works out in the end, but I just thought, because usually we get that update, like, okay, what happens to this person later on, but I think it's probably just, like, Gia's able to, she's maybe still, you know, playing basketball, or maybe even coaching people who are in that situation, not only, you know, having sports be an outlet for people in the community who maybe feel alone or feel ostracized, and be able to kind of, like, pay it forward, you know, how so many others were there for her, now she gets to be there for so many others in those circumstances. So, I thought it was kind of a beautiful episode in that regard. And I think it's an important story to tell, especially them, like, obviously having the message at the end, if you're, you know, a trans kid in particular, you know, once again, it's a struggle. I think it's a struggle even for an adult under those circumstances, but also a kid in the process of, you know, at an age where you are trying to figure out who you are. That's such an important time too. So, like I said, I thought that was powerful in that regard as well. But another element to this episode is the name that Janice gave Addison. Jin and Magic are looking into it, and it's a person, Dottie, who ended up kind of does like a slam poetry thing and seems very like, oh, like the government's hiding stuff from us. I was like, which is interesting considering, like, yeah, we do have like people who are working on this secret government project in front of you. And it's like, because Dottie was like, oh, this person came in March 13th, and that date struck a nerve with Dottie. Dottie, March 13th, was like, what's so significant about that? Because she didn't seem like she knew about what about Ben or was very cagey about it. And it's not until the poem started happening and Magic kind of leaned up, I was like, someone leaped into her body in that moment is when I figured it out, is when Magic figured out. Because in that moment, the way she was talking about, because we know Magic was in that same regard. We know Sam, like, leaped into his body back in the day. So it's, like, interesting. So he ends up talking to Dottie about it because Dottie remembers the face in her dream. So it's like, oh, like, let me show you what this is, this person's face. And if I'm not mistaken, that looks like that's Ian. I was like, and it looks like an older Ian, the way, I don't know whether that's just like the caricature of like the drawing itself, but it looked like it was just like an older Ian. So I'm like, Ian's from the, because so that means Ian's the one that warned Ben. So that's an Ian from the future where this whole thing with Addison or everything else that happened already happened. So Ian, I guess like maybe eventually down the road, Ian eventually leapt back trying to talk. I'm curious. This is what I'm wondering. We know that I think Addison was the original leaper. So part of me wonders that's where we start getting into the save Addison thing because. So part of me wonders like in the, once again, like I brought this up last episode, Magic being like, right, what if Janice was part, and Magic and Jen being like, what if Janice was part of the team? Would we be friends and stuff like that? Like I brought up at last episode, I referenced the magicians, like Julia in this particular, in the final, like ultimate timeline that the story is kind of built around. Julia never made it to break bills. The whole point was she wouldn't be there. And that ended up being such a crucial thing in this timeline. So I'm curious if that same thing's applicable here where I brought up like, what if Janice was never, that was something they changed in this particular timeline. What if that's the same thing with Addison? What if Addison was the leaper, but things didn't go right? So now they ended up making Ben the leaper instead to change things. So I'm wondering like Addison's future. Well, maybe things still ended up happening then, if that's the case. Because that's the thing, what I think is interesting too. Why wasn't Ben the one that ended up traveling back to this point in time? It's like maybe Ben got lost just like Sam and Ian went back in Ben's place just to make this happen. I don't know. Because we don't know what the team looks like. Who, like I said, it looks like a significantly older like I said, it might just be the drawing itself. It might not be that far in the future, but we do know that Ben is building up enough speed to go to the future. Maybe just any point in the future would need, you need a significant amount of like build up speed and trajectory and momentum. Or maybe it's because you're trying to go to such a further point in the future that you need this very specific momentum and build up, you know? So I don't know. It's definitely going to be interesting to see what that's all about, you know, but that does beg the question, like, what happened? And you wonder, does it have some relation with Leaper X? And the fact is that Leaper X is like, Ben, I know you're following me. Maybe that's, Leaper X thought he was Ben from the future, and like, a future timeline where maybe it has something to do with Addison, and it's like, oh, I know you're following me, and maybe that's why. Well, or maybe it's supposed to be in reference to, like, Leaper X is there because things didn't work out. Like, maybe Addison died or something during all of this, and Leaper X got brought in, and then Ben followed Leaper. It's like, or maybe Leaper X is like, oh, I know you're following me, Ben, but it's like, wait. I don't know. There's so many, there's still a missing pieces to the puzzle, but I'm so curious to find out what that's, you know, all about. It's definitely going to be interesting to see where all that ends up taking us going forward into the next episode. And once again, I made this point last episode, which I thought was interesting too. We never got to see where Ben ended up at the end of last episode, where most episodes we do. In this regard, we're back to Ben being like, oh, we know that Ben's like maybe like a chef at a restaurant or something like that. So that's, you know, that's interesting. I think that's such an interesting thing. Maybe because of the context of this episode, they wanted to leap. Because the lead into that leap, maybe they felt like it's like, no, we don't want to just end an episode off on that. We want to begin the episode with that jumping into the leap, understanding the context of things. We don't want you to, like, because they would have only played, like, because typically they only play a couple seconds into the leap, maybe like one up to a minute into the leap. So they probably needed it to, the whole lead in to, you know, make the story hit even harder. So you come into it being, oh, like being like, okay, what's this leap about? And then finding out about G. And, you know, so I think that's probably why they didn't do that last episode. Maybe I'm reading too much into it. Either way. But really, I'm excited to see where the next episode ends up taking us going forward with all of this. But really, that's all I want to talk about today. Next time we meet, be happy, be safe, live life to the fullest, and enjoy it. Good day and goodbye.